Now we talk about the magnitude of limiting friction. As we have discussed that a limiting friction is the maximum magnitude of a static friction. Here we can see the magnitude. This magnitude depends on two factors. The very first is the normal reaction between the surfaces, and the second is nature of roughness. Obviously, roughness is more, surfaces are more irregular, the value of limiting friction will be high. And if normal reaction is high, then also we can say, as the surfaces will push each other with more force, the value of friction will be more. So here we can see the limiting friction is directly proportional to the normal reaction between the surfaces. Here, if we introduce a proportionality constant, which is written as mu, this mu, or more precisely it is written as mu s, it is called coefficient of static friction. This is a coefficient which depends on roughnesses of the surfaces in contact. It depends. On roughness of surfaces. If surfaces are more rough, the value of a static friction coefficient will be more. So, this mu s multiplied by n, the product of normal reaction and coefficient of a static friction for the pair of surfaces in contact. This is called the magnitude of limiting friction. The application of limiting friction we can understand better with the help of a practical illustration. To understand limiting friction in a better way, we discuss a practical illustration. Say on a rough surface, we place a block. A block is given of mass 5 kg. And say the friction coefficient, the coefficient of a static friction between the surfaces is 0.3. Now in this situation, we can directly state that the normal reaction between the two surfaces in contact, that is of ground and that of body, here it can be written as phi g. Because if we just draw the free body diagram of the block, in downward direction it will experience a force mg, and in upward direction it will experience a normal reaction. And as it is at rest, we can say n is equals to phi g. That will be 50 newton. And here if we find out the value of limiting friction can be written as mu s into n. So this will be 0.3 multiplied by 50, that is 15 newton. So the limiting friction between the block and the ground in this case is 15 newton. If we apply a horizontal force F onto it and try to slide the block, we know that as soon as we apply the force, static friction will appear over here. We just talk the values of static friction for different values of external force. We can say if we increase the external force to 5 newton, we can simply say as it is less than limiting friction, the value of a static friction will also remain at 5 newton and the body will remain at rest. We can also talk about the state of motion of body. Now in next situation, if we increase the value of force to 12 newton, again we can say as it is less than limiting friction, the static friction will still balance it and the body will still remain at rest, and static friction will balance it, no motion will be there. If we increase the force to just a limiting value of 15 newton, say 14.99 newton, again as it is less than 15, the static friction will be 4.99 newton, body will still remain at rest, but as soon as we increase the value of force to 15 newton, the static friction will no longer be able to balance the external force, as at 15 newton the interlocks between the body and the ground surface will break and the body will start sliding at this instant, the static friction will no longer exist. Body will start in motion. It will start moving. And the friction at this instant we call Fk, or this we define as kinetic friction. Obviously, we can say as the body starts moving, the interlocks are now open. So, number of contacts in case of motion are certainly less than the number of contacts compared to the case at rest. So, kinetic friction can always be written as lesser value of limiting friction. Then only the body is going to move. So, we can state the friction which was acting on the body when it was at rest. This we can call as a static friction. And as soon as the external force approaches the limiting value, the body starts in motion, which we define as kinetic friction. Now, let's discuss about kinetic friction in detail. Now, about kinetic friction, we can see that it acts when body is in motion. We can also state when body is in motion, no external force is necessary for kinetic friction. Unlike to the case of static friction, where we have studied that a static friction will act only when some external force is also acting on a body. Say if on a rough surface, a body is in motion, say a block of mass M is moving at a velocity V. Here we can simply state kinetic friction is acting on it. As ground has applied kinetic friction on it in backward direction, body will also exert the friction on ground in forward direction, as any force we have already studied, it never act alone. It is always appearing in pairs. Be careful about friction. In case of a static friction also this is true, that whenever friction appears, it appears in pairs. On block, it is acting in the direction opposite to the tendency of motion, and in case of ground, it is acting equal in magnitude and opposite in direction. And here the magnitude of this kinetic friction can again be written as it depends on the normal reaction acting on the body. As with the more force body will push the ground, more will be the friction. And in this situation, the proportionality constant we write as mu k. And this mu k we call coefficient of kinetic friction. And as we have studied that in case of body, when it starts moving, the static friction reduces to kinetic friction as number of interlocks are reduced. So, we can write down a note. When a body starts moving, due to less interlocks, between surfaces, kinetic friction is always less than limiting friction, and as it is also written as mu n, we can simply state coefficient of kinetic friction is less than coefficient of static friction.